Good morning. It's so good to see everyone today in the house of the Lord. We're so glad to have you here if you're visiting with us. And I just have a few announcements to make. If you look in your bulletin, you can find out more details about what's going on. Triple L will be meeting on Tuesday at noon. I think Miss Nancy Boyd is going to be the guest speaker. Also, I wanted to remind everybody to look at the estate planning little flyer that's in the bulletin. If you are interested in that, I do believe it's free for just to come and to get information about this. Please call June at the office so she can make reservations so they'll know how many people to prepare for. The other thing that I was asked to be sure and tell everyone, Miss Susan is away on vacation today. She'll be back next Sunday, but she wanted me to thank everyone for all of your help and support Wednesday night, for everyone who made desserts and brought them, for those who helped with cooking the food, and for those of you who so generously came and ate and donated. We raised almost $800. The only other thing I have is just to remind you that Bible school is coming. Please be in prayer for our workers, for the children who the Lord might send to us, so that we can be a witness to these kids and to their families, and they can learn about the Lord. So please be in prayer for that as the time gets closer. Now let us open our service today in prayer, and we'll get started. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for your many blessings and for all the things you've given us. Thank you for the beautiful weather. Lord, we pray that you'd be with each person who is traveling today who isn't with us. Lord, that you'd watch over them and keep them safe and bring them back safely to us. Lord, be with us. Let thy Holy Spirit come upon us and dwell within us and encourage us and strengthen us and lead us in our lives. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
This is a reading from Acts 2:1-21. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they said, or they asked one another, what does this mean? Some, however, made fun of them and said, they have had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will turn into darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And all God's people say,
amen. Just stand. Sunday. This is the day in the Christian church year that commemorates the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the lives of the disciples and the other believers as they were in Jerusalem. And it also fulfills the promise that Jesus gave them that we see in the book of John, that God, Jesus promised that he would send the Comforter and the Spirit of Truth will come upon us. And he is still with us today. When he came back then he's remained and he is still with us today. We're wearing red today, some of us, as a symbol of the fire of the Holy Spirit. So we're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. We especially welcome our guests. And we just ask that if you don't mind, fill out that fly leaf on the inside of your bulletin and put it in the offering plate as it's passed a little bit later in the service. Our pastor and his family are on vacation this week, and we are just delighted to have our own Reverend Bobby preaching for us today. He's preaching from Ezekiel, and I know he's worked really hard on this sermon. So we're praying that the Lord will give him recall and speak to us today as we learn more about the Holy Spirit. At this time, I'd like to invite our children to come down the front, meet Miss Lisa, and if you would take a moment to greet one another, especially our guests, and greet one another while they're coming.
The adults are busy talking this morning, but that's okay. You know, when I was younger, much younger, I had two older brothers, and my brothers were really, they loved to, I mean, they would do tinker in the workshop, and they would make things, and they were always building things and experimenting with things. And over again, they tried to explain to me how electricity works, you know, how it's made and how it makes the light bulb come on. And I just never could quite understand it. But I did know that when I went to the light switch and I turned the light switch on, that the light would come on most of the time, unless it was the bulb was burned out and I could fix that. But there are some things in our lives that maybe we just don't understand the full grasp of how it works. But we know it works, right? Like electricity. So today is Pentecost Sunday, when we talk about when the Holy Spirit came down and indwelled all the believers. And the Holy Spirit's sort of like that. The Bible talks about, or we talk about, the Trinity. And the Trinity is one, but it's three separate beings. It's God the Father, who lives in heaven, God the Son, who is Jesus, and God the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, the old part of the Bible, would come down and would dwell in someone for a period of time. And those people would become prophets, and they would tell about what God's plan was for the Israelite people. The good things that were going to happen and the punishments that would happen. It was the Holy Spirit who dwelt in people who gave them the words to write the Bible. So we have the Bible. And in Jesus' time, Jesus was here, so the Holy Spirit wasn't amongst us at that point. But Jesus told his disciples, he said, I have to go up into heaven, but God is going to send his Holy Spirit to dwell in you and to show you how to live and to help you. So Pentecost is the time when the Holy Spirit came down and all the people who were believers received the Holy Spirit. And it gave them power to be able to be witnesses for God. And now, these days, when you become a Christian, when you believe in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes and lives in you. And it's up to you how much you listen to the Holy Spirit. Okay? And the Holy Spirit helps you understand the Bible as you read the Bible. The Holy Spirit helps you understand what decisions to make. The Holy Spirit reminds you of the things that you've read in the Bible and the things you've heard in Sunday school and in preaching to help you understand better how you should live. So the Holy Spirit's a very important part of our lives, and sometimes we forget about that. And we need to always remember that He is living in us if we are a believer, and that we should listen to Him, and as we pray to God, He will speak to us through the Holy Spirit and help us to live closer to Him. Okay? And as I said, it's sort of like that light switch. Don't understand exactly how it works, but it doesn't really matter because I believe God's Word and I know it does work. So I don't have to understand the why. Okay? Or the how. All right? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for these children. Lord, we pray that You would watch after them, that You would protect them, that You would help them to grow in knowledge and in strength and in all things, and that You would keep them close to You, be with their parents and their grandparents, be with all the people of our church, Lord. Bless us and help us in all things to look to You for answers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This is a reading from the 16th chapter of John's Gospel, beginning at verse 7. Very truly, I tell you, it is for your own good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father. And about where you can see me, I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own, he will speak only what he hears. He will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is for me that he will receive what he will make known to you. This is the word of the Lord.
We'll sing together our hymn, Pentecostal Power. This will be our offertory hymn this morning, so I invite you to stand with me as we sing.
Thank you.
deacons to come forward to receive this morning's offering. This is a special part of our worship service as we are given the opportunity to return to God a portion of what he has given us. And we do that with joy and with gratitude. And Deacon Tony Tabor will lead us in our offertory prayer this morning.
Well, we've got some good news. Thank you, JJ Ministries, Jim and Jim, for once again, the metal ministry. $1,000 to the Way Forward makes $89,000 since April 11, 2011. So thank you, guys. Psalm 8, verse 4 says, "What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name." Let's worship him as we pray for this offering. Heavenly Father, today is a beautiful day, but help us to see the beauty in every day, no matter what season it may be, no matter when the rains fall. And also, Lord, with the seasons in our life, help us to also see the blessings that you always are, for you're always there with us. Now let us return a portion of the gifts that we've received to give back to you. We humbly pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Join together in a time of prayer and a few needs that I am aware of. Margaret Perry was hospitalized early in the week and released and is doing better. Donna Mullins fell this week and broke her collarbone, and we want to be sure to remember her in prayer. Also, we've had two family deaths just in the last day or two. Gary Land's brother, David Land, passed away yesterday, and Margie Oliver's uncle passed away also yesterday. So we want to remember both of these families. We have lots of folks that are traveling, and we want to remember them. It's almost time for the end of school, so the end of the school year for our kids. Many, many things that we want to just continually remember in prayer. We're so grateful for the Lord's presence and for his comforting spirit to be with us. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you once again for this time that we have together. It's just such a privilege for us to join together as a church family, as believers in your Son, to join together, to lift our hearts and our spirits together in worship. Father, we thank you for what you've done already in our time of Bible study this morning and in the service, how you've met us here. We're so grateful for your presence and your spirit. Lord, we do want to lift these requests that we have been made aware of today for Margaret Perry and Donna Mullins, and for Gary Land and his family, and Margie Oliver and her family, and for the needs that are represented within these lives. Lord, we just ask that you would minister to them and take care of them, that you would bring comfort where comfort is needed. Father, we also pray, asking that you would take care of our folks who are traveling, particularly our staff, our pastor, and Susan and her family, that you would just bless each of those who are on the road and give them a safe time away. Father, we also ask at this time that you would just forgive us for our sins, for where we have failed you in the past, and even in recent days, that you would restore us unto yourself, that you would help us to strive to be more like you every day that we live. Father, we ask that all of these things, and ask that as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I will be reading from Ezekiel 37. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied and I was commanded. And I was prophesizing. There was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and the tendons and the flesh appeared on them and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say it. This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come, breathe from the four winds and breathe into this slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breathed entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the Sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that the Lord hath spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Well, good morning. Great to see everybody here this morning, and it's a privilege and honor to be able to be up here and share with you, so I thank you for that opportunity. And here's the moment of confession. So the cartoon honestly has nothing to do with the sermon other than that's what came to mind when I was thinking about Ezekiel. Perhaps everybody has seen the full cartoon before. Yeah, and who would believe that I would know a cartoon that came out in 1929? But I love that one. It's funny. And that was the image that I had. And so Thursday, when we were talking about it, we, Daryl and June and I, got the idea, well, we'll just do like a little minute excerpt from the cartoon to show. So it was just something fun to share. But, you know, this morning as we gather here to celebrate Pentecost Sunday, you know, perhaps to you, Ezekiel seems a very odd passage to focus our attention on. I mean, we're used to hearing Acts 2 preached. God descends upon the gathered believers and then empowers them and ends up sending them out into the world. And we're used to hearing that. Or we're used to hearing selected readings from John's gospel. Or perhaps various readings from Paul's letters, which he talks about the work of the Spirit. But Ezekiel? I mean, really? Ezekiel? And what I have come to learn, oftentimes in Baptist life, so this is a moment of confession, is that we do several things, but one of the things I've learned is we don't talk about the Spirit at all. I've been in churches where that's been the case. Or we talk about the Spirit, but the work of the Holy Spirit is very limited in our conversation. And typically it's what comes to mind when we read Acts 2, or we talk about the Spirit in the work of salvation in the individual believer's life. And so this morning, I believe Ezekiel will be able to help us think perhaps a little bit more fully about the work of the Holy Spirit, not only in our own lives, but in the world around us. Now, I think it's important for us to have just at least a snippet of some context of what's going on with Ezekiel. So let's keep in mind that the community to whom Ezekiel is talking about, they're in exile. They're in, you know, the Babylonians in 587, 586 BCE, which, depending on which scholars you're reading, they came in to Jerusalem, ransacked the city, carried many of the people off to Babylon. The few that are left in Jerusalem, which is a few, well, they're an occupied people. They're a conquered people. They're not governing themselves anymore. And of course, you've got others that are off in a foreign land. They're away from everything they've known and perhaps even separated from some of their families. And of course, the temple, the place that they went to worship God, completely destroyed. So I can imagine in that context, there are some questions that are swirling around in the minds of the people. Where is God? Where is God in the midst of everything that's going on? Has God forgotten to be faithful? Has God rejected them forever? Would they ever see their homeland again? Or would they ever see their homeland restored again? Just as I think about maybe even asking those questions, the possibility of even asking those questions, I can't help but get a sense of perhaps the despair and maybe even a little bit of hopelessness that people are feeling. And it's in that context that we learn that the prophet slash priest Ezekiel is given a vision by God. And this vision is one that's very dramatic. I mean, we heard it read. There's no doubt that there is dramatic imagery. And perhaps in today's context, for a lot of folks, and I know a lot of folks that watch this show, but it would conjure up images of the popular television show The Walking Dead. I mean, because it's very dramatic imagery. And no doubt it was dramatic in Ezekiel's day as well. But it's a vision that when shared with these people, this community of people, one that would instill great hope for their future. And so we're told, as the vision begins to unfold, that God takes Ezekiel out. He sets him down in a valley. And of course, Ezekiel, he can look around and he sees that this valley is full of nothing but dry and dusty bones. And of course, as if Ezekiel can't just look around, God is going to lead him through this valley so that he could take a few moments to gaze upon what I would envision to be heaps and mounds of dry and dusty bones throughout. And as I think about this valley, I have no doubt that most likely where Ezekiel finds himself being set down is an ancient Near Eastern battlefield. And as would be a lot of times the custom, the conquering army would not have allowed the defeated to bury their dead. So we can imagine that these bodies that Ezekiel is gazing upon has been there for some time. The work of decomposition has taken place. And now he sees mounds of dry, dusty, brittle, perhaps bleached by the sun, bones laying around. Now, there can't be any doubt. There's nothing that exists in this valley except lifelessness. That's all that is there. And as Ezekiel is gazing upon the bones, he hears the voice of God calling out to him. Mortal, can these bones live? And of course, as if to say, well, you know that they can live, Lord. Ezekiel responds, Lord God, you know. Now, at this point, I need to interject. Because Ezekiel is getting ready to share with us this vision of restoration for this community of people. But it's important to keep in mind that after his response to God's question, the vision suddenly becomes participatory. God's going to restore life to this community, but God is going to give Ezekiel a role to play. And so Ezekiel is commanded to prophesy to the bones. Prophesy to the bones and say, oh bones, you shall live. And of course, there's something else there that we need to keep in mind as well, because the imagery is very dramatic. The people, the life is restored to this community, but it doesn't happen instantaneously. And sometimes I think we miss that subtlety, but there are stages that are going to take place. God tells Ezekiel, I'm going to bring the bones together. They're going to live, but I'm going to cause sinews or ligaments to come upon the bones. I'm going to cause flesh to come upon the bones. Skin will come upon the bones. And then breath, life, if you will. And we're going to talk more about the breath here in just a moment. But there's stages. It doesn't happen instantaneously. And so as the vision unfolds and Ezekiel prophesies and declares that the bones will live, just as God had told him to do, I can imagine the sounds that Ezekiel hears as the bones begin to rattle and come together bone to bone. Now at that point, I'm probably thinking, I'm going to get the heck out of here because there's something strange going on. But Ezekiel stays. And he witnesses the bones come together and skeletons have formed, fragile skeletons, if you will, because there's not anything binding them together at that moment. But then before his eyes, the ligaments, the sinews, begin to take shape, binding these skeletons together. strengthening them. The flesh begins to come upon the bones. The muscle coming upon the bones. What once was a fragile skeleton, now far less fragile. Then gradually and slowly, I can imagine as Ezekiel is watching the skin that forms over these skeletons, forming all of a sudden this vast army of people standing before Ezekiel. And yet we learn from the text that those bodies that stand before him are still lifeless, because God's breath had not entered into them. Now that this concept of the breath in Ezekiel is very important. You can't neglect it. In fact, it's so important that it's mentioned no less than 9 times in this passage. 9 times. And of course, when we hear breath, or the Hebrew word God's ruach, and I know I butchered that, Daryl, but we hear that term, and perhaps another way that we could translate it, because it can be translated this way, is God's spirit had not entered them yet. So these bodies stand before Ezekiel, and God's life-giving spirit had not entered them. So they were still lifeless. And there was nothing that Ezekiel could offer to truly restore life to this community. But once again, God asks Ezekiel to participate in that life-giving work, because God tells Ezekiel to prophesy to the Spirit. And God, in typical fashion, gives Ezekiel the words to say. Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy to the Spirit. And say to the Spirit, come from the four winds and breathe upon these who are slain, that they may live. And as Ezekiel prophesies, as Ezekiel calls upon the Spirit to descend upon those, that community before him, to sweep through that community before him, imagine that they felt some sort of a wind blowing through, and the life is breathed into this community. They're restored wholeness of life. The work of death, the work of decay, suddenly reversed. Now, I think at this point, there's no doubt in my mind this community whom Ezekiel would have shared this vision with would be reminded that at the moment of creation, God's spirit, God's breath is what is breathed into the human being whom God formed out of the dust. And Ezekiel is not the one that brings the life to these lifeless bodies, but his words speak life into a community that was lifeless. His calling upon the Holy Spirit is calling for God to breathe new life into this community, to restore them to wholeness. Now, again, Ezekiel's vision is one for a particular community of people in a particular time in history. But I have to ask this morning, church, do we share Ezekiel's vision for the life-giving work of God's Spirit? Do we share Ezekiel's vision for God, through the work of the Spirit, to restore life to individuals and communities around us? We share that vision? Have we, like Ezekiel, been taken out and set down in the midst of those valleys where nothing exists but dry and dusty bones? And have we taken time walk around and gaze upon the dry and dusty bones in our world? Have we taken the time to really pay attention and to hear the cries and the pleas of desperation from the poor in our society, and understand the shame and the hurt and the stress that that causes, all the while our society tends to favor the wealthy and so at times criminalize those who are poor? Have we taken time to hear the pleas for some solutions, whatever your leanings may be, and whatever mine may be? Have we at least heard the cries of the people who are saying, we've lost loved ones to senseless acts of violence, and we've got to figure out ways to get these things under control? And I'm not calling for one solution. I don't think there's one. But have we heard those cries, those desperate cries? Have we heard and are considered the heartache and the sense of loss that comes along with the fear that comes from families who either find themselves separated or fleeing from their home countries due to violence, perhaps seeking a better opportunity for life, only to arrive here and hear the message, we don't want you here? Do we hear those cries? Do we hear the cries for communities of people and individuals who suffer the hands of injustices in our society, who need a voice because they have none? Do we hear those cries? Do we see those valleys of dry and dusty bones in our midst? Do we walk around and hear their voices and hear their stories? Try to understand where they are coming from. And I can promise you this, if we do that, then we will not be able to not hear the voice of God crying out to us, mortal, can these bones live? Can these bones live? Now, I would hope that our answer is going to be, Lord God, you know. But I have to interject here, because I think we can respond one of two ways, even when we answer affirmatively. We can respond with conviction. Yes, absolutely. We know. Through the work of your Spirit, God, these bones can live. These communities can be restored to wholeness of life. And we understand that God's going to give us a role to play in that. Or we can respond affirmatively, yes, they can live, but how? And what would you have me to do about that, God? What would you have me to do about that? You really want me to participate in the work that your Spirit is doing in those communities? My hope is that we would respond confidently and affirmatively. And that's not to say that as a church we're not already participating in the work of God's Spirit in those places where God is breathing new life into communities and individuals. I mean, we do that already through participation with the identified missions partners that we have selected for the coming year. We do that when we support, whether it be financially or physically, ministries like Olive Branch Ministries or Elam Ministries or Water with Blessings or Habitat for Humanity or the Zambia Mission. We do that, we're already participating, because I have no doubt that God's Spirit is at work in those places, in those communities, breathing new life into communities where people are hurting, people are struggling. But I have to ask the question, are there ways the church as individuals that we can more fully participate in the work that God's Spirit is doing in those places. And that's something that we have to discern together. But I also caution us to not just say, well, we're participating in the work of the Holy Spirit to restore communities to wholeness of life because we're doing those missions partners. Because what we have to remember, right, it is the Spirit who empowers us. We read about this at Pentecost in Acts 2. It's the Spirit who descends upon us and empowers us as Christians. It's the Spirit who sends us forth. But let us also not forget that it's the Spirit who goes before us. So in a lot of these communities where there is need, where there is need for hope, we have to remember that the Holy Spirit is already there and is already at work, breathing new life. And so we have to discern where those places are that the Spirit is at work. And then we have to be willing to go and join in. Because I think the misconception is a lot of times that, you know, the Spirit's at work in those places only where the church is involved. But I think the Spirit is already at work well before the church ever arrives on the scene. But we're being called to go and participate. And when we do go and participate, sometimes speaking words of life, like Ezekiel was called to do, doesn't solely mean that we go and we prophesy with our words only. Sometimes it means we prophesy with our actions. So yes, we speak words of life that say God is in the midst of this community. But perhaps it also means that we're going to have to work to advocate for communities that have been forgotten. Perhaps it means that we're going to have to stand up to some injustices in our society and say this is not right because this does not bring life to groups of people. So perhaps we're going to have to take part through our actions. But we have to keep in mind that it's not our actions that's going to bring the life, ultimately. God's Spirit. God's Spirit that will breathe new life where once there seemed to be a lifelessness. But we have to remember we're called to participate. We're called to participate in that work. And as we open our eyes and look around and we listen and we try to imagine those places where God's Spirit is sweeping through communities of people, I can guarantee you we are going to hear the question posed to us. Can these bones live? Question for us this morning. How will we respond to God's call to participate in the life-giving work of the Holy Spirit in those communities? You all pray with me this morning. Lord, we come to you this morning. We thank you for this Pentecost Sunday. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit. And it is our prayer that you will open our eyes, our ears to hear, and even our imaginations to begin to see those valleys around us where seemingly dry and dusty bones exist. But those places where you are also at work through the work of your Spirit, breathing new life into those communities. We pray that you help us discern your call, become involved in the life-giving work that your Spirit is doing in those places. We pray that you just shape us, form us, and strengthen us to participate in that work. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Well, this morning, I'm going to ask our deacons to come forward as we prepare to share in communion together. And it's fitting that we're going to share in communion as we have reflected on the work of the Spirit, because in Christ's brokenness, we're reminded that we are given wholeness of life. But when we partake of communion, we also don't just remember the wholeness of life that comes to us from Christ's brokenness, but we are also reminded that the Spirit is present among Christ's church. And the Spirit, as we are partaking of the elements, reminds us of that newness of life that we receive through Christ. But the Spirit is also shaping us, transforming our lives so that when we go out of this place, we are prepared for the task of sharing that opportunity for newness of life with the world around us. Morning, I invite you, if you are Christian and you're coming here and perhaps you're not a member of this church, but you are a member of another church of Like Faith and Order, we open our table to you. This is not First Baptist's table. This is Christ's table, and it is Christ who is calling us to this table. Scriptures tell us that on the night when our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took the bread, and after offering thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat of this bread, remember me." You all pray with me. Loving God, we just give you thanks for the gift of Jesus Christ and for the wholeness of life that we have received and the gift of newness of life we have received through brokenness. And we thank you that you are continually shaping us to go out and serve others as Christ has served, to be the body of Christ to others. We thank you for that gift. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. After the dinner, in like manner, he took the cup. He said, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for the remission of many sins. As often as you drink of this cup, remember me." I'm going to ask John Vaughn to offer the blessing for the cup this morning. But at this point, we want to offer you the opportunity to respond however you would feel led this morning, whether that be